our fourth baby came as a surprise, from finding out, you know, the confirmation on his birthday, to learning of the gender on Christmas Day, to seeing her, you know, 3D, 4D ultrasound images on my birthday. Everything about this pregnancy was special. The days following my birthday, I had this really intense itching. The itching was so severe to where, like, literally I was scratching the skin from my legs. So ended up seeing this provider the same day, and during my appointment, she checked my fundal height, and then she noticed that baby was measuring small. So at that point, it was suggested that I see the doctor every week now, as opposed to every other week. So go in the following week for what I'm thinking is a routine ultrasound, only to learn something changed. You know, baby's heart is now enlarged, and there's some concerns about activity, you know, that's going on with her brain. I immediately reached out to Dr. Orbach's team. If there was an opportunity or intervention that could save our baby's life, we were definitely gonna go for it. We felt very confident in reaching out to Dr. Orbach because we learned that at that time, it was only two doctors in this country that specialized in this. This man is an expert.
For a vein of Galen malformation, the vein itself is a big vein right in the middle of the brain that gets this very fast flow, high pressure arterial blood, and the vein actually blows up like a balloon right in the middle of the brain. In utero, the placenta is there as a very low pressure, high flow, basically sump pump that's taking a lot of the burden off the heart and the brain, and probably protecting the heart and the brain until the baby's born. And once the baby's born and that umbilical cord is clamped, that's gone, and now the entire burden of that circulation is on the baby's heart and brain, and that's when they start to get really sick. Babies often need a breathing tube, they need all kinds of medications to support their heart function, and many of the survivors have significant neurological and cognitive issues. So the thinking was, if we could undo that abnormal flow before birth and protect the heart and brain before the pathology happens, rather than trying to reverse it, we might have a better chance of improving the outcomes.
A lot of work has gone into developing this trial at both Boston Children's Hospital and Brigham and Women's Hospital. We've worked for a long time with Dr. Orbach in a collaboration, trying to take his experience from treating newborns with vein of Galen malformation and assembling a better approach. He had spent a long time with us going through the physiology, how he thought that trying to intervene before the baby was born would save the infants from the complications that they often experienced, as well as how could we approach it as maternal fetal medicine interventionist. Can we get a needle placed across the skull accurately where we want it to be? Can he see his coils as they go in? And then what are going to be the obstacles?
In order to be included in the clinical trial, patients have to meet two criteria. Criteria number one is they have to be in that high risk category. And criteria number two is the brain has to not be injured yet. And when they sent us the scans, it was clear that Denver fit this profile perfectly.
When he expressed what would happen with the clinical trial, to me, it was a no-brainer. Like, we have to do this because this is gonna give our baby the best chance at a normal life.
My role as maternal fetal medicine specialist was one, to keep an eye on the mother with the maternal anesthesiologist to make sure that she's doing well. And then secondly, to help move the baby into position, and then under ultrasound guidance, getting the needle placed within the vascular mass in the brain. From there, it will look to Dr. Orbach and the others who are doing the coil placements very much like how it would look if the baby was on the table.
as we deployed the coils, one thing that popped out immediately was that you can see the flow on the ultrasound. They turn on color Doppler, and at the start of the case, there's this pulsating, colorful mass in the middle of the brain. And then as we were deploying these coils, that flow was just diminishing very dramatically. So that was fantastic and sort of instant feedback that this was going well.
You can read the faces in a room, and they had masks on, but you can tell, you know, those smiles were so big.
Teaming season, and like a couple strips. Everyone was holding their breath, watching the numbers very carefully and waiting to see how her heart and the transition to being a live born was going to be handled. And she, you know, she showed all of us that she was a fighter. She was going to make it.
It was just apparent from the beginning that she was fine. She was born, did not require any medications, no cardiovascular support, didn't need a breathing tube in the NICU. Denver turned out to be just the right patient at the right time, and it was definitely exhilarating to be able to treat her and finally, after all these years, you know, have this success.
We're excited to get back home to our kids, being able to reunite them with their baby sister that they've been just anxiously waiting to meet. Denver may be small in size, but she has this large personality. She loves music. And I want her to know, even after we've gotten through this journey, just how much potential, you know, she has to reach the masses and to make a difference in other people's lives.